So today's topic is called Open Type Color Fonts in PDF. I would like to show the underlying technique for demonstrate for using all these the nice emoji and smiley pictures that you can see on the cover page. And our question is how to implement this in fonts and how to convert it to PDF. A small about page. You may know my name or the company name. We are a rather old company in the PDF space. I personally started in the mid-90s doing PDF work. And ever since, we have been selling PDF-related software. And I have also been active in the former PDF A Competence Center, which evolved into the PDF Association, the host of this event. So I grouped the presentation in the following topics. In the first section, I will present the currently existing OpenType color font flavors. There are several competing color font formats, which are all standardized in OpenType. The second section covers the use of emoji. The Unicode standard did a lot of work in standardizing emoji, so smiley and other symbols. And in the final section, we will take a look at how to implement color fonts in PDF. So why would you want to use color fonts? So far, the existing font formats like TrueType and PostScript have always been monochromatic. They are not actually black and white. They only describe the shape of glyphs. So we have an outline which can be filled. It's usually filled with black color, but can also be filled with another color. But the important point is that you can use only a single color to colorize a font. This has been true for decades, and color fonts now change this. The new idea in color fonts is that individual glyphs bring their own color. Thinking of the well-known smile face, you have a yellow face and some face features in black, and this yellow and black color comes directly from the font, from the glyph description. Of course, everybody knows, is familiar with the use of emoji from their mobile devices. It's very common to send the smile face and other similar features in text messages. And of course, you also have them in web applications. It's a smaller area, but color in fonts is also used for artistic purposes. Sending smile faces and other emoji from one font to another, especially from different brands, only makes sense if these are standardized. So Unicode plays a very important role regarding the exchange of emoji. As a personal note, I personally believe that emoji are actually a big step backwards. For thousands of years, mankind developed very efficient system of writing, and now we try by adding thousands of pictograms to the Unicode standard, we actually go back to the system that, which was already in use in ancient Egypt, where they used a similar system. It's nice to have the occasional emoji in the message, but there are actually thousands of symbols, which is really a lot for standardization and implementation. But let's go back to the technical side of things. On this slide, I have a couple of samples of commercial color fonts. You have seen emoji on the cover page and in everyday use on your mobile or on web pages. And on this sample page, we have color fonts which use the intrinsic color for some artistic purpose. In the OpenType standard, which is actually standardized as an ISO standard, it's hidden away in some other standard called information technology, coding of audiovisual objects. And here in part 22, we have the official OpenType font specification. And the current version of this standard, which comes from, which was published in 2019, includes all four flavors, which I will present today. So in general, we have to take into account that color fonts include more information. And for this reason, they also require more disk space and space in documents compared to monochromatic fonts. Hinting is an important concept to improve the visual representation of text at small sizes. And interestingly, three out of the four color font formats don't support hinting. As always, with new technology, we have to take into account that it will be implemented only step by step. So not all systems and applications support color fonts today. I will talk about specific applications later. In most fonts, we actually have fallback glyphs, which can be used by older applications. So you can use the font, but without color. Talking about color is also related to transparency. So in the color fonts, you can also use transparency, which can be used for typographic effects, like in the top example, or it could be used to simplify combinations of glyphs. For example, the scientist in the example has transparent glasses because otherwise her eyes wouldn't be visible. The first format has been specified by Adobe and Mozilla. It's called OpenType SVG. Each glyph is described by a small vector graphics description by the standard, using the standardized SVG format, which means I have lines and arcs and other vector graphics. I can use transparency, I can use smooth shadings, patterns, and masks. Since SVG can even include raster images, you can also use raster images in this kind of font. You may know that SVG includes a wide variety of features for implementing interactive features, but for obvious reasons, the interactivity and scripting and animation is not supported in fonts. You don't want this in most cases, maybe with the exception of web pages, but in any case, it's not required to support these features in OpenType fonts. For each font format, I will mention reference fonts in the sense that if you are interested in this format, you are invited to take a look at these fonts by the respective vendor. These are high quality fonts, which are not in all cases freely available, but should be rather easily accessible. So, for example, the Adobe Emoji One Color font comprises 1800 emoji glyphs, colored glyphs in the SVG flavor, and it comes at 4 megabytes, which is rather a lot for a single font. The Trajan Color Concept font, I have a sample here, is modeled along Roman Latin font and intrinsically supports more than a dozen different colors. And you can see the shading and transparency effects. SVG fonts are supported in Windows 10, and macOS also introduced support for them 2 years later. The second format is called Microsoft OpenType Color, C-O-L-R, as in the corresponding OpenType font table. They use a completely different technique of layering glyphs. So you start with the first layer and assign some, let's say, red color, then put another layer, which is colored in green, next layer in blue. So each layer has only a single color, but by combining the layers, you can construct multicolor emoji or other glyphs. Since the individual layers are taken from the existing OpenType font, they also support hinting, which is important for improving the visual representation. There's an auxiliary OpenType font table called the CPAL, which includes the color palette. So you can even change the color palette, for example, for different kinds of background. There's an advanced version, which will also support shadings and transformations and gradients, but this is not yet, this is specified, but fonts are not yet available. It's not yet supported in the operating system. The reference font for this format would be CGO, which is one of the Windows standard fonts, which is used for the user interface. It also supports several thousand of emoji glyphs and is 2 megabytes large. Also supported in Windows and macOS. The next two formats I will cover only briefly, as these are bitmap formats. Apple SBIX, as in standard bitmap graphics, basically includes a ping image or multiple ping images for the glyphs at different sizes and resolutions. This is a rather simple approach, but of course, as you can see in the example, it suffers from visual artifacts if the glyphs are scaled to a large font size. The reference font can be found in macOS installations. The Apple Color Emoji font is available since 10 years in the operating system. It comes at a whopping 156 megabyte, which is due to the fact that multiple sizes, bitmap sizes, can be included for each glyph. Finally, Google invented their own format called CBDT, Color Bitmap Data Table. In principle, it's similar to Apple's format. It also packs ping images for the individual glyphs, but it's not as widely supported. So I won't go into detail here. The well-known Noto font family also includes an emoji font, Noto Color Emoji, which can be used if you want to take a look at this format. So using Unicode for exchanging documents, including emoji, Unicode 6 in 2010 started to standardize emoji, and ever since they expanded the set of standardized emoji. Currently, only a few weeks ago, Unicode 14 was published, and it contains more than 3,600 emoji glyphs. There's an accompanying standard called the Unicode Technical Standard 51, which details emoji processing in astonishing detail. So many aspects of handling text with emoji characters is specified in this Unicode standard. So if you want to implement emoji support in some application, you should take a look at this. One aspect which is discussed in Unicode, emoji sequences. They make use of a zero-width joiner, which is a special character which is used to combine two neighboring characters, but doesn't show up itself. Here are some examples. So usually in applications, the user will only see the result in the right column, but technically these glyphs are comprised of separate characters. So in the first row, you can see man plus woman plus girl combined results in the family. You can apply skin tone. You have a face plus a certain skin tone resulting in a light skin face or dark skinned face. Flags can be combined, combining the country code results in a flag. You can assign gender. We have a mermaid plus the male symbol, resulting in something which is called in Unicode a merman. I have no idea what it's called in German, but in any way, you can use it and you can exchange it. And you can continue this way and also attach skin color. So now you have a male, dark skinned mermaid or merman. Another example are hair components, including red hair and bold headed and so on. There are many role symbols, like this crop symbol combined with a face, results in a farmer. There is a long list available on the Unicode website regarding the sequences. Regarding fonts, usually the OpenType feature CCMP is used, which defines glyph composition and decomposition, which means that the application takes the input glyphs, applies the rules from this font feature table, and then the resulting emoji glyph shows up. Here's a more elaborate example, how to create a scientist with dark skin and gender attached. You start with a woman, you add the skin tone, then along with the zero width joiner, you add a microscope, and then end up with a female scientist. Now, moving on to the question of color font implementation in PDF. The bad news is that PDF up to version 2 doesn't include any kind of support for these four color font formats. These are just too new and have not been included in PDF yet. So the old style alternative would be to rasterize color glyphs, but of course this has many disadvantages. You cannot search the text. It looks ugly and has many disadvantages. So a better alternative are type 3 fonts, which are available in PDF since the initial versions. They are very flexible and can be constructed from any kind of graphical content, be it raster, vector, shadings. They can even pull glyphs from other fonts. They can use transparency. They can be colorized when the glyphs are used, or they can have intrinsic color. So these are perfect for implementing color fonts in PDF. Of course, they have also some disadvantages. Type 3 fonts exist only in PDF documents. It's not a standalone format, which you could use for exchanging fonts or for installing in the operating system. A PDF viewer cannot access local fonts in Type 3 format. They just exist inside PDF documents and nowhere else. They don't support hinting, so the font display, text display at small sizes may not be as nice as with regular OpenType fonts. The big technical restriction is that Type 3 supports only 8-bit encodings, which means you are limited to a maximum of 255 glyphs per font instance. There are a few tricks that you can use. You can add many more glyphs to a single Type 3 font, and then create subfonts, which can be regarded as a window into the 8-bit window into the large font. But these are implementation tricks. Another old requirement are glyph names. The glyph addressing in Type 3 font is not based on Unicode, but on old style glyph names and encodings. Another important question regarding fonts in PDF is subsetting. Usually you don't want to embed the full font, but only a subset font, which includes all the glyphs used in the document. But with Type 3 fonts, it's not really clear what a subset is, since usually you don't have a full font as a reference. In this particular situation, we do have a reference in the original OpenType font. So here it makes sense to talk about subsetting in Type 3 and remembering the large file size of color fonts. It makes a lot of sense in order to bring down the file size of PDF documents. A related question is whether or not to use a subset prefix. As you can see in the screenshot, Acrobat knows about subset for TrueType and CRD fonts and removes the random font name prefix, but since it's unspecified, it doesn't do anything regarding the font name prefix for Type 3 fonts. So it doesn't mention that it's a subset, and it doesn't remove the random prefix. That's related to the fact that type 3 subsetting as a concept doesn't exist. It's not standardized or described anywhere. So a few specific words regarding color fonts. Remember, this is the Microsoft format. They use the layer approach, and the individual layers are pulled from the original font. This means I have to embed both the original OpenType font, which brings the glyph parts, and then construct a Type 3 font, which uses parts of the OpenType font and applies color. And going back to the previous screenshot, which is actually from the SIGO Windows font, you realize that we have the same base font name, SIGO UI Emoji, and we must embed the original TrueType or CRD font, and then we can construct a Type 3 font which references. So in order to use only, a single smile face character, we must use both fonts in combination. This is a particular feature of the Microsoft Color format when used in PDF. A very positive aspect is due to the fact that glyphs are taken from the original font, we actually do have hinting. This is the only format, color font format, where we have hinting for small text sizes. On the downside, the number of glyphs in the font goes up tremendously. The reference font SIGO UI Emoji includes more than 12,000 glyphs because we have full glyphs and also parts which are used as layers. This makes the font rather large in terms of number of included glyphs. Taking a look at the use of color fonts and PDF standards, I already mentioned transparent glyphs, which are possible in most font formats. And of course, if you have to create PDF A1 or PDF X3, you don't want transparent glyphs because these are not allowed in these standards. So consider the situation, poor user creates a document, does not create transparency in any of his graphics, but then silently a single glyph slips in and introduces transparency in the document. So you have to be careful when using color fonts in combination with these standards. The tagged flavors of PDFA and the main accessibility standard PDFUA require proper Unicode mappings. These can be attached to a Type 3 font in a data structure called the Unicode CMAP. Regarding emoji, it's important to keep in mind that most of the emoji characters live outside the basic multilingual plane in Unicode, which means they need more than four hex digits and must be represented as a surrogate pair in the two Unicode CMAP. So the application must implement support for surrogates. Color management is also an important topic for PDF standards. And this is rather easy as SVG color and CBDT explicitly require sRGB for the use of color. In APIS format, sRGB is possible, but not required. So coming to closer to the end, I'd like to present one of my favorites, the question of accessibility and emoji. So how do we actually read emoji? I can see a smile face, but how is assistive technology supposed to read it? Or the broken heart or any other of these many symbols. And there's an interesting answer. The Unicode standard not only standardizes the codes, but also the descriptive names of these characters. So taking a look at these examples, the broken heart, this name is actually derived from the Unicode standard. I didn't come up with this name, but copied it from the Unicode standard. So the idea is that assistive technology can use the standardized Unicode names when reading text with emoji characters. And this is actually what Acrobat does when you activate the read out loud feature. In the handout pod related to this presentation, you can find the slides that I'm using. And I also put a small test document, which is the image also used on the cover page of the presentation. If you are interested, you can use it and try the read out loud feature in Acrobat DC using this document. And you will find that it actually is able to read all the animals and other colorized images, GIFs. So coming to the end, I can summarize very easily. No, there's no support for OpenType color fonts in PDF available, but yes, you can use them. You don't have to rasterize them, but you have to get familiar with the details of Type 3 fonts. I would also like to mention that in the next slide, at the end of the slides, I assembled a number of resources and web addresses, web links. So if you are interested in more detail, you can go on the web and find out more information. So thanks for your attention, and I am open to questions.
Tomas, thank you so much. That was fascinating. Just as a reminder, you can download Tomas's slides and the example file that he mentioned in today's presentation from the handouts panel. And we're now able to start answering some questions that have been submitted. And actually, you did just address, or you began to address one of these questions in one of your last slides here. But are these types of fonts inherently accessible, Tomas, or do they require any sort of additional work once a PDF has been exported?
Well, the accessibility of a font is defined by its Unicode mappings. So as long as you know the Unicode value, the Unicode slot for a particular character, you are able to deal with it. In the early days, we had like symbol fonts, which didn't include proper Unicode mappings. And of course, it's impossible to read or otherwise interpret fonts without proper Unicode mappings. So this is not an issue in current fonts.
Okay. Okay, great.
Regarding the emoji, we have Unicode values, but the question is how to deal with them. Speech synthesis software knows how to combine Unicode characters to words and to words to sentences, but it's a rather new question how to pronounce, how to speak emoji. And this solution using the Unicode character names for reading makes a lot of sense. So it's very nice to see that Adobe implemented this method in Acrobat.
Mm-hmm. Next question, how do color fonts work with PDF's text rendering model?
The viewer doesn't actually know about color fonts. It knows about the specified font types, which are the well-known types in PDF. And using type 3, it just falls back to the existing, well, should be existing in the viewer, the existing implementation of type 3 rendering. So there's nothing special for color fonts. That's also the nice thing about it, that existing technology can be used, which is compatible to old and very old PDF viewers.
Mm-hmm. You said these colored fonts are sRGB. How do you specify this? Using ICC, CalRGB, or something
it's,
else?
Actually, part of the specification, the OpenType specification, explicitly says that, for example, these RGB values must be interpreted in sRGB. And from now on, it's up to the application how to implement it. So if you produce PDF using this font, you must reference or you must embed the sRGB color profile.
Okay. You mentioned that many new emoji are in the very latest Unicode 14 specification. Will Unicode text extraction or read aloud work if software is older, is pre-Unicode 14?
That's a general problem if applications are supposed to communicate and support different levels of the Unicode standard. So if you buy the latest, let's say, mobile phone, which implements Unicode 14, which may be possible next year or so, and send messages to someone with an older device, the new glyphs will probably not work. And the same applies to text extraction and all other kinds of text processing. If you have any text processing pipeline, it will support a particular version of Unicode. And the same holds true for accessibility and read aloud. A certain Unicode feature will be supported and Unicode version. And for newer versions, the names are just not available to the software.
So it's really important for anybody interested in these features at all to encourage their vendors to adopt the latest Unicode. I think that's exactly what you're saying. Yep. Okay. Can you use emoji for PDF passwords?
That's going to be a very technical answer. There is, so Unicode passwords are possible in PDF?
I'm sorry?
For example, like umlauts or Arabic text or whatever, for many years, this is possible. However, there is a very subtle algorithm which goes into a lot of detail regarding how to pre-process Unicode strings in order to use them as passwords. This is important because you need unique passwords. If you have two different spellings or let's say ordering, like you have a German umlaut with separate umlaut dots, or things like that, you must normalize the passwords, the string, in order to use it as a password. And this is specified for PDF passwords. The interesting question is whether all kinds of PDF software implement this algorithm. So usually users are happy with ASCII or let's say European or Latin passwords. So the answer is, in theory, it should work, but it would be interesting to see whether it's actually compatible among different PDF implementations.